Sabbath, built on a diverse foundation.
Welcome back. It's the Business Breakfast. 24 minutes before 8. These are your top business stories.
Business headlines on Dubai Eye 103.8.
With JAFSA, accelerate your F&B business with competitive end-to-end logistics solutions for the whole F&B industry. Visit jafsa.ae or meet the team at Goldfood 2023.
Dubai saw the highest growth in prime property rental yields in the world last year, according to new research from Savills, and the second highest in terms of capital value growth. The guys from Savills join us live in about 45 minutes' time.
Trade between the UAE and India has climbed 10% over the past year to $50 billion. Foreign Trade Minister Thani Al-Zaidi made the announcement on the first anniversary of a UAE-Indian trade deal known as SEPA.
Amazon's told staff they must work from their office at least 3 days a week. The Amazon CEO, Andy Jassy, saying that face-to-face interactions built culture, promote learning and drives innovation.
Meta has announced plans to sell the coveted blue ticks on both Facebook and Instagram, costing $12 a month.
And Asian stock markets slightly lower on the first trading day of a brand new week. Oil little change. Brent crude around $83 a barrel.
You're listening to the UAE's number one talk radio station.
This is the Business Breakfast
on Dubai Eye 103.8.
Where we're talking about the world of work.
Come Monday morning, I'm the first to arrive. I ain't nothing but business, y'all, from 9 to 5. I'm a hard working man.
People are going to be working hard at Amazon from the 1st of May because the boss, Andy Jassy, has said you must come to the work most of the time and at least 3 days a week. Going to get the thoughts of one workplace strategist shortly. But first of all, let's hear from Dr. Amanda Nyman-Peters. She is a behavioural scientist and professor of leadership at Hult International Business School in Dubai. She says the move by Amazon is part of a long-term response to hybrid working.
To put this into the perspective of a widespread trend, the disruption of the past few years was also a huge opportunity to test new working models. So we had pre-2020 when office work was mostly unquestioned, and then of course almost 2 years when remote work was largely unquestioned, and then 2022 with really a hodgepodge of approaches that weren't planned but were more like unintentional evolutions. And that's evidenced in the fact that before this announcement, individual team managers could decide what was best for their teams. I mean, that might suit some team leaders with the skills to make those decisions, but it would have left many other team leaders without any guidance on what is best practice. So what we're seeing here is an example of a large multinational basically re-equilibrating its policies into a sustainable long-term approach to hybrid working.
We've got a poll going on Instagram this morning asking you the question, in your view, which works best? Three options: work from home, office full-time, or hybrid, and it's roughly split three ways down the middle. Joining us in the studio to give us some perspective on this is Oliver Baxter, founder and the owner of Workplace Maven. It is a workplace strategy specialist organisation. Oliver, good morning. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having me back.
So if you were going to be voting in this poll, work from home, office full-time, or hybrid, which one would you have clicked?
I base my opinions on kind of what the data is saying right now, so I would go with hybrid. It seems to be the winning horse in the race so far.
Okay, why do you say that?
Okay, so if we compare data from year on year and quarter from quarter from, say, the Future Forum as an example, we see that actually people's preference for working fully remote or fully in office is actually coming down, and the majority of people seem to want to go with the hybrid solution. We also have a couple of misnomers, which has been highlighted in the Amazon statement around hybrid working, saying that it might not necessarily be good for culture or for productivity, when actually the opposite is true. So if we look at the last quarter data from the Future Forum, we see a 57% spike in culture in those organizations that actually have hybrid, an 8% improvement in productivity. And if you actually have schedule flexibility, then you get a 39% spike in productivity. So you've got to remember, hybrid isn't just about the where, it's also about the when you work. It's schedule and location we've got to take into consideration.
Well, if we look at what Andy Jassy's saying, and this is for office staff at Amazon, it seems to me that it is a kind of hybrid model. He wants you in there most of the time. That's not all of the time. You've got to clock in at 8 and leave at 6. And he suggests 3 days a week is a minimum. But that's still, I would define that as hybrid. Would you define that as hybrid?
Yeah, Nick Bloom from Stanford would describe that as structured hybrid. You've also got fully flexible as well. So that's people who are in the office less than 50% of the week, which is actually where Amazon were before. They were in 2 days a week predominantly. And they have some really good working culture as well, and it's getting better. They have some of the best paternity leave actually in the region as well at 6 weeks. So I think this is probably a little bit of a step back for Amazon in comparison to where they were a year or 2 years ago in terms of that flexible strategy.
It's going to impact me and Brandy and Tom because Amazon are in the floor above us here in Media City, so the car park's going to be a little bit busier. Although we do get in before most people around about 5:30, so we should be all right on that. Well, let's look at some of the breakdown, some of the things that Andy Jassy of Amazon says the office helps with. He says, for example, collaborating and inventing is easier and more effective when we're in person. The energy and riffing on one another's ideas happen more freely. He says a lesser known fact is that some of the best inventions have had their breakthrough moments from people staying behind in a meeting and working through ideas on a whiteboard, or just walking back to an office together on the way back from a meeting, or just popping by a teammate's office. Is that a myth or reality? What does the, to use your phrase, the data tell us?
No, that's absolutely a reality, and I completely agree with those statements, but that's not all of the time in all instances. Many people actually like to ponder a problem on their own before they bring it to the group. Brandy was talking about introverts earlier on. That's the demographic that prefers to do that. Typically, when you're in a meeting, you're just going to hear the voices from the extroverted people like me. And then when that meeting finishes and the tension of the social situation reduces, actually you start to get those ideas coming in that riffing fashion, as you mentioned, from the introverts. So you get some really good ideas after the meeting has finished and also before the meeting starts, because it takes that social pressure away.
We heard from Dr. Amanda Nyman-Peters of Holt Business School, and she said one of the potential risks of doing this, of having what you call structured hybrid, at least 3 days a week, being more dictatorial most of your time in the office, is that you can lose some staff. Because if the tech company down the road is offering a far more flexible form of hybrid and the same salary, everything else is equal, but one company's offering proper hybrid and the other one is something more rigid, you lose the staff. Is that a clear and present danger?
It is. If you look at Hayworth's data from their Spark Insights series, you'll see that 80% of the under 35s have like hybrid working, flexible working as their number one priority, and they're willing to leave if that's not on the table, at least for consideration. We know that the tech industry is actually leading the charge on this. 80% of tech firms are actually in that flexible model, so in the office for less than 50% of the time. So actually, Amazon have just moved out into that structured hybrid phase and moved out of the fully flexible phase, bucking the trend of tech firms in that segment.
How different is it here in Dubai or different parts of the Middle East to, say, Silicon Valley? Rightly or wrongly, I've got this idea in my head that a lot of bosses like to see their staff in the office. If I'm paying you a salary, I want to see you in at 8 and I don't want you leaving till 6. Is that a myth?
No, it's reality. It's the command and control culture that we have over here. And I don't think it's doing very well for the talent. We know that we have such a transient talent here anyway. We have one of the biggest brain drains in the world, just because so many people are moving in and out of the country for whatever reason. But then if you couple that with working cultures that don't fit in with the rest of the world, you get lots of people job hopping in different industries as well. It's a really big issue for our industry. And it costs about 160,000 dirhams over the course of 2 years to train up a new hire. So if you're looking at your people as ones and zeros on a balance sheet, please take that into consideration, that training people, there is a cost to that as well.
Finally, what does all this mean for the way that we design workspaces?
Well, I would say that they're going to need significantly more private spaces when they come into the office so that they can do focused work. For Amazon on the floor above you, they're probably going to need to start taking more space again. There's going to be a cost involved with that. Those spaces for long duration collaboration, we're going to have to redefine those. Short duration, we're happy to jump on a call, you know, for an hour or two. Anything longer than that, then you get Teams tiredness or Zoom fatigue. So we're going to have to rethink those collaborative spaces, those individual focus booths, not just dedicated for seniority, but open and accessible to all. And then we could probably reduce a number of the desks and chairs in the space. We could pre-pandemic. We really should be able to do that post-pandemic. We don't need a desk and a chair for every single employee in the office.
Oliver, thanks very much indeed for joining us this morning. As ever, appreciate your insights. Oliver Baxter is the founder and owner of Workplace Maven. This is The Business Breakfast, Dubai Eye 103.8 FM. Keep your messages coming on this one. Really appreciate it. You can get in touch 4001 or you can send us a WhatsApp 04871 5500.
Dubai Eye 103.8 traffic.
Traffic on the roads of the UAE is busy this morning. Monday morning, schools are back, and we are seeing it as well. E311, E11, both heading southbound at the moment towards Dubai International Airport. A lot of traffic being reported there. There's an accident just in the Garhoud area. Turns off just opposite Le Meridien Dubai Hotel. In front of the Dubai International Airport. That's causing a few issues there. You've also got issues a bit further down. Junction between JVT into JVC, you know, the Dubai Sports City roundabout, or junction, I should say. That is busy. Accident for you southbound on the Sheikh Zayed Road. That's causing issues coming past Maidan. It's a bit nasty already. Sorry.
Dubai Eye 103.8 traffic.
Coming up next, Thomas, the economics of the sea.
Yes, we're turning our attention to the marine. We're talking to the team from Al Seer Marine. Why? They are showing at Navdex this year. What be Navdex? Like IDEX, but on water as well. So we'll be looking ahead to that. That one's getting underway in Abu Dhabi. Record numbers for Al Seer Marine throughout the last year. We'll talk to them about.
Weather check. With Air Arabia, from admiring mountain views to strolling through city squares, fly for